So may I request Deepak ji to please share some few words with regard to today's topic, and please welcome Bata ji.
Thank you, Sumit. Thank you. Good evening, friends. CA Ashok Batra ji, today's guest speaker. CA Nitin Kanwar ji, member NIRC. CA Navya Malhotra and other distinguished guest and participant, a very warm welcome to all of you. Friends, as you all aware that we all are struggling with this COVID-2019 pandemic and staying at home. Last week, I was listening to Shri Shri Ravi Shankar ji, a spiritual mentor and guru, and he said, during this lockdown period, kindly stay at home with positivity and develop your skill. So in this regard, CA Nitin Kanwar and his entire team took the initiative and designed the series on GST to develop the skill of all the members of CA fraternity and for their team for the next 12 days. Dear friends, we have distinguished faculties with us for the next 12 days and hope we all will be benefited a lot after listening these speakers. Wish you all the best. And the entire team of CA Nitin Kanwar ji, Sumit ji, Global CA, and stay at home, stay healthy. Now over to Sumit ji.
Thank you, Deepak ji. I'm very thankful for your kind words. To say some few words.
उसका मैसेज आया है, मेरा पेन ड्राइव हो गया है, सिस्टम लोड किया था, सिस्टम कोड हो गया, सारा डेटा समाप्त हो गया।
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई जस्ट वांट टू थैंक अशोक बता जी टू स्टार्ट दिस इनिंग। मैं जीएसटी की बात करूं और अशोक बत्रा जी की बात करूं, तो जो सचिन तेंदुलकर क्रिकेट के लिए, अशोक बत्रा जी इज फॉर जीएसटी, जैसे उन्होंने सर्विसेज किया जीएसटी के लिए, or to start to open the innings from like if somebody is doing a batting like Sachin Tendulkar jab bat karte hain to sir aap main aapko ye aapke madad se batana chahta hu sir jab maine humne 2 baje innings start kiya by 3:30 already got around 2500 runs
already sare chal rahe hain
रेशन अब दिक्कत ही आ रही है तो मुझे ये फोन कर रहे हैं कैसे हो रहा है तो सबको मुझे ये बोलना पड़ रहा
है तो न्यू प्रेस तुम अलग किए हो ना लेक्चर को
थैंक्स अ लॉट
राइट के नाम से जो लेक्चर वो वाला लेक्चर में भेज रहा
हूं शुड आई स्टार्ट
यस सर
गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स At the outset, I would like to thank Knowledge Tree or Global CA and more particularly Mr. Nitin Kanwar, who is the promoter member, for providing this opportunity wherein I can share my views on this very interesting topic of IT.
So,
professional colleague, my humble request to everyone, please switch off your phone. I am getting so much of noise from Sumit's phone at least. Sumit, kindly either talk slowly and my humble request to
And mute all the participants also.
My request to participant also kindly mute
their audio.
And another mistake, another request, sorry, I want to make. Today my internet is unstable, so in case I goes off the air, I will join you once again, but without video, so that internet quality or the voice quality does not get affected. With this. Now I am going to share my screen. You let me know if you are able to see the PPT. Is it there on your
perfect,
screen?
Perfect, sir.
Right. Now we will start with the topic. Friends, today's topic is input tax credit. According to me, this is one of the most important topic of GST, and if I say it is one of the objective for bringing GST into operation. In the Rest-Wise law, the problem of cascading effect was there, and in order to remove that cascading effect, they introduced GST, and in reducing their cost getting effect, this subject of GST is playing a very, very important role. Of course, the government has not been able to achieve the full objective because still there is a cost getting effect, because custom duties are not being subsumed, because the place of supply, there are certain CGST, SGST, which I am not able to take credit if I am registered at a different state. Similarly, some of the items like petroleum products, liquor for human consumption is outside the GST. But yet, still it has been able to achieve the objective, I will say, to the best possible extent. Even here, I would like to mention, if you look at the place of provision of service rules in service tax, there are only one set of rules which were governing domestic and interstate transactions. Now, in order to have a better the tax credit mechanism and no cost getting effect, they had two sections, section 12 and 13 of IGST Act with regard to services, and section 10 and 11 with regard to the goods. And for the services, they are specifically having two sections, because the domestic transactions, the place of supply is being treated as the place where the recipient is registered, meaning thereby, so they have tried to adjust and avoid the cascading effect, for which I input tax credit is playing a very important role. It is one of the most beneficial provisions for the suppliers under GST. I said it's the only beneficial provision in service tax also, and because they provide benefit to the supplier, they have been subject to maximum litigation. If you look at the erstwhile law also in excise and service tax, if you look at the cause list, I think 25% of the cases were always relating to the sunbelt issue. And I'm sure in the times to come, there are certain drafting issues also in this law. So according to my understanding, this input tax credit shall remain a subject matter of discussion even in the times to come. In my humble submission, this is the soul of GST. Now, friends, claim of credit or non-claim of credit has very serious financial implications. If I fail to claim a credit for which I was entitled to, the loss is the amount which I have failed to credit less the income tax benefit for which I am entitled to, because I am claiming that amount of ITC as an expense. I'll give you an example, taking our fraternity itself in view. You are a chartered accountant, 100 rupees is the invoice, 18 rupees is the tax credit. You were entitled for the credit of 18, but you failed to do so, and you expense your profit and loss account with 118 rupees as expense. In case you would have availed the credit, you would have expensed 100 rupees in your profit and loss account. Meaning thereby, by not claiming the credit, I am losing 18 rupees. At the same time, I am reducing my income tax liability because of increased expenditure available while computing my taxability. So if I am liable to be taxed at 30%, then 5 rupees 40 paisa may be the saving in income tax law. And my loss will be 18 minus 540. And this loss may be 100% also, where my income is not liable to be taxed. It can be 30% also, where my taxability is more. But the minimum loss is minimum 70% of the credit which you have failed to claim, for which you are entitled. Secondly, excess claim of credit certainly result into adding to your tax liability the amount of tax credit which you have claimed in excess, plus interest and penalty. And we all know in all this fiscal law, particularly in service tax, excise, and now GST, they can serve me a notice 5 years after the relevant date. So approximately 6.5 years is available to the department. So when they will serve me the notice, this 100 rupees will become 300 rupees. I have to pay tax, interest of 100 rupees, and penalty of 100 rupees. Not only that, wherever there is a condition that I am entitled to the concessional rate of tax, subject to claim of non-credit. And inadvertently, I claim that credit. So sometimes the department doesn't ask me to repay the amount of credit which I have wrongly availed along with interest and penalty. Rather, they deny me the concessional rate of tax. I'll just give you an example. A transporter who is supposed to pay tax at the rate of 5% without claiming the credit. Let us say that transporter inadvertently claimed 5,000 rupees as credit and his turnover is 1 crore. So the department, rather than asking 5,000 rupees along with interest and penalty, can also ask you, okay, bhaiya, because you have claimed the credit, you have denied the condition of the concessional rate of tax. So your turnover of 1 crore shall be subject to tax at full rate of 12%. That means the demand of 7 lakhs may be created rather than demand of 5,000 rupees of input tax credit wrong. So friends, kindly try to appreciate this. Non-claim of credit result into huge amount of loss. Excess claim of credit again attracts the liability. So it is a dodhari talwar, I will say in Punjabi. So you need to take a very conscious call whether to claim the credit or not. And nowadays, when the credit scope has gone beyond the local boundaries of tax or the central taxes, it is available across the board. You must have seen from your experience that the profit amount is always less than the amount of credit claimed by anyone. If we talk about construction industry, the credit may be 11 to 12%. In the case of trader, it may be 70 to 80% of his turnover. And what is his profitability? Let us take an example of trader where it is very easy to understand. A trader is doing a business of 1 crore, 80 lakh is the purchase, and his profit is 2 lakh. On 80 lakh, assuming his claiming credit, his item is taxable at 12%, I'll take 10% for the sake of simplicity. So 8 to 10 lakh is the tax credit, whereas his profitability is only 2 to 3 lakh. So once you be not careful in claiming the credit, then obviously this can be a problematic area and your whole profit can be wiped out because of this. Then friends, the concept of tax credit is not a new. In 1986, for the very first time, VP Singh introduced with the introduction of MAT, first of all. Then we have seen the credit in excise law converted into SEN VAT. Then we have credit mechanism in service tax. When the VAT was introduced, then there was a credit mechanism in VAT also. But if you look at all those credit mechanisms, it is entirely different than the GST. That is why I am focusing more on this, because the mechanism in GST is entirely different than the one which we had in the past. In the case of service, the credit was available. The subject matter may be the same, input service, inputs or capital goods, but it was linked with the provision of output service. In VAT, the credit was available on turnover of purchases used for the purpose of sale. In excise, the credit was available, of course the subject matter was same, for the manufacture of the final product, either directly or indirectly. One-to-one relation was not there. But in GST, it is not linked with any of the taxable category. Kindly try to appreciate this. In GST, the credit is linked with the in the course or furtherance of business, not a taxable activity. So earlier on, normally credit has nothing to do with the profit and loss account. It was only the trading account or manufacturing account, we can say, in the case of excise. Now, GST is available throughout, either it is a trading account or profit and loss account, because all the expenditures are being incurred in the course or furtherance of business. What is the meaning of in the course or furtherance? We can discuss a bit later when I'll come to the statutory provision. But what is really important to understand is, okay, now this input is not linked with the taxable activity or taxable event or not the charging section, but with the whole activity which is being carried out in the course or furtherance of business. Secondly, we have further seen another change, and that is credit is available when it is being used or intended to be used. The word intention is being used for the very first time in this credit mechanism. And it is not like that if the government want to finance your stock, because whatever closing stock is lying with you, you have paid the GST and you are claiming the credit in the same month. The government is financing the GST amount on your stock. It is not to facilitate your working capital, because the government was very clear they want to verify and administratively manage each and every credit mechanism, each and every invoice. So in case they have not used the word intended to be used and the credit was available only when I am using that particular input or input service, then this mechanism with the help of the machine with minimum human intervention was not at all possible. I'll give you an example. AK Batra and Associates has purchased 10 computers. If the credit is being given to me only when I'm using the computer, I put to use the computer, then department could not have verified this transaction, because this transaction could have gone to 2 financial years, 3 financial years. I may having certain spares which I hardly use or which will be used only when the need comes. Low stock moving items can be there. But the department want to see, becomes a businessman. Okay, if Mr. A has sold 10 computers to Mr. Batra, let us say for 100 rupees and 18 rupees is the GST, he is paying 18 rupees. I am willing to give you credit 18 rupees right now. Absolutely no problem. Because by doing so and not linking it with the user intended to be used, I am verifying each and every invoice that has been properly recorded in the books of the recipient. I can match invoice to invoice. That was the initial scheme also. Unfortunately, that 1, 2, 3 mechanism could not work out. And now we are filing GSTR 1 or 3B where we are claiming the credit. Whereas the credit should have come to me automatically once the supplier is filing GSTR 1. It must populate in my GSTR 2. Now it is populating in GSTR 2A. Still, there are so many flaws and technical issues with regard to that credit also. Then Rule 36.4 is again a subject matter of dispute. So I'm not going on that. I am on the fundamental concept of GST. So these two basic differences are there. Now the credit is available even if the goods have not been used or intended to be used. And credit is available in the course of furtherance of business independent of the output tax liability. When we want to rely on a case law, which is there in the previous law, as I told you from 1986, the moderate concept is there. We must keep these two differences in mind. And then only we should say whether it is applicable or not. Now, what exactly is tax credit accounting term? I'll try to explain the tax credit. In accounting terminology, it is the amount of tax paid on the receipt of goods or services which is not being expensed or capitalized. Obviously, in case I expense or capitalize, then credit is not available. And the amount of credit is being debited as a current asset in my books of accounts as cash and bank balance. And that credit can be used for the discharge of tax liability. And it cannot be used for the purpose of payment of any interest, fine, penalty, or any other sum due under the Act. Even when it can be used for the discharge of tax liability, there is still one exception. Once you're liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism, either under 9.3 or 9.4 or 5.3 or 5.4 of IGST, that payment of tax has also to be made in cash only. So far as EOU, ESTP, STP units are concerned, they are still not liable to pay the custom duty, but they are liable to pay IGST. Of course, if they satisfy the other condition, then they are also entitled for the credit also. Now, friends, I'm going to discuss certain principle which are not specifically being stated in the statutory provision, but which is settled by various judgments in the past. First such principle is classification cannot be challenged in the hands of the recipient. If you are a supplier you are issuing an invoice to me and you are charging a tax which is less than the amount of tax which is leviable on that item, you can be subject to tax. The department can serve you a notice, department can make your inquiry, can recover the amount which you are less paid. But so far as I am concerned, I will be entitled for the tax which I have paid on my supply as a credit. Vice versa is also true. If the item is liable to be taxed at 12% and I charge 18%, it can be because of two reasons. There are two kind of practices which are going in the market. People are charging 12 also, 18 also. There is a classification dispute which is not being settled. And I want to be conservative. And if it is a B2B transaction, my customers are also not objecting to the same because they are also entitled for the credit. And once that credit is available to me, then there is no financial implication. Even finally, it is being settled that this item is liable to be taxed at 12%. Nobody can object to it. If I have paid 18 rupees, I am entitled for the credit of 18 rupees without any dispute. Yes. If I am raising an invoice by 12% and ultimately it had to be 18%, then for the differential, I can be served with a notice. But so far as ITC credit is concerned, that cannot be denied. Once whatever amount has been charged by my supplier, I am entitled for the credit. Then there is another confusion. So once I pay the tax under RCM, and that tax is being paid at a concessional rate where tax credit is not available, will I be entitled for the credit? I'll take a very common example, and that common example is of transport of goods by road. There are two options available. He can charge me tax at 12% and claim the full credit. Second option, he can charge me tax at 5% without any ITC. So once he's charging 5%, I am making payment of 5%. So the bar on input tax credit is at the end of the supplier. As a recipient, as a chartered accountant, if I have purchased certain furniture on which I have paid the cartage and on which GST is being charged, I have discharged that liability. I will be eligible to claim the credit of tax paid to the goods transport agency, maybe under concessional rate of tax. So that is one thing I want to say. Second, as I was telling you, when we were discussing the classification issue, once there is a doubt, what is the rate of tax? And my business is normally B2B. If you will see, in Sadar Bazar, where our wholesale dealer, there 99.9% transactions are B2B. And in the case of companies also who are manufacturing industrial product, etc., their transaction is also mostly B2B. If it is a B2B transaction, then I need not be very enterprising. Rather, I should take a conservative view, and whatever the rate of tax, which is higher when there is a doubt, I should charge the higher rate of tax because ultimately it will have no financial implication, including working capital. In the month, I'll pay the amount, I am eligible for the credit, and B2B transaction is there. How it does not have any financial implication, I'll make it clear by way of an example. Let us say there is a dealer who deals in ready-made garments. His turnover is 1 crore. Tax is 10% for the sake of simplicity, 10 lakh. Now, out of this 10 lakh, he has to pay or deduct the amount of tax which he has paid on the input services, input on capital goods. Let us say it is 6 lakh. Then 4 lakh has to be paid to the government. You can't make profit out of taxes. And in case this input tax increases to 7 lakh, how does it make a difference? I'll pay 3 lakh to the government. So once it is a B2B transaction and there is a doubt in the rate of tax, undoubtedly you should follow the conservative rate, the higher one, because the other person is liable for the tax. Now friends, coming to another important issue, credit once availed, it is indivisible, cannot be taken away by any act or any statute. I can use it or utilize it in the same month, in the same financial year, in the coming financial year, or in the times to come. Absolutely no problem. Once you have availed the credit, it becomes indivisible current asset, which can be used for the purpose of discharge of tax except RCM for immortal times. Then second important issue is, you have to avail the credit as per the law prevailing at the time when the supply is being received. Later on, if there is some change in the law, your credit cannot be denied. I have purchased one thing today which is taxable. I have paid the tax and I am claiming the credit. Day after, there is an exemption notification that item becomes tax-free. My credit cannot be denied. Similarly, we have seen in the case of Alembic Limited, builder's case, where he was claiming the credit because he have already sold his project 90%, 10% was likely to be sold. But because of unfortunate circumstances, it could not be sold. Now the department said that you are liable to reverse your 10% credit. And most of the builders have done it also practically, not to buy dispute with the department. But one of them has gone into the dispute. And Gujarat High Court Ahmedabad bench stated, no, he availed the credit as per the legal proposition at that point of time, so he is entitled to the credit. Another issue which is being debated upon is whether ITC is an absolute right or it is a concession being given. Certainly, Supreme Court in the case of ALD Automotive Private Limited clearly said it is an absolute right, but with conditions. Whatever conditions have been specified, and those conditions can be substantive conditions, procedural conditions. Once you satisfy the substantive condition, you are eligible for the credit. The procedural lapses will not come in your way. This I will explain in detail when I'll come to the statutory provision. Then friends, now coming to the GST, if you look at the GST law, then these provisions have been contained in Chapter 5 of CGST Act, having section number 16 to 21. 155 is one section under miscellaneous provision, last chapter, which according to me is a very important one, but which is not being listed along with the input tax credit provisions. So I have clearly mentioned it separately. 155 deals with the burden of proof, where any person claims that he is eligible for ITC under this Act, the burden of proving such claim shall lie on such person. So initial burden, it is not the absolute burden. It is the initial burden which has been shifted on the recipient. What does it mean technically or practically? It means once I am claiming a credit on the purchase of certain goods, I say this is the duty paying document invoice which is in my hand. I am having an e-way bill. I have made the payment through banking channel. This material has been recorded in my stock record. In production record, it is being shown as a consumption. And finally, a goods has been manufactured out of it on which the GST has been paid, or it is being sold as it is. Even then, tax is being paid. So if that being so, my initial discharge of burden stands settled. Now the ball moves to the court of the revenue. Now it is for the revenue to decide whether they claim that this invoice is bogus, this e-way bill is not correct, your stock record is incorrect, then that onus lies on the department. So this section simply says the initial burden of claiming the credit lies on the person who is claiming the credit, but once he is able to discharge his initial burden, then revenue has to prove why he is not entitled for the credit. This credit is subject to two very important section 49. We all understand IGST can be used for the discharge of CGST and SGST, but vice versa is not possible. CGST cannot be used for the discharge of SGST. And this SGST and CGST are also state specific. 41 talk about provisional credit. Initially, it was supposed to come when the GSTR1 is being filed. It should have come to me. Later on, now it is in 2A, which is being reflected once I'm filing my GSTR1A. So it is a provisional credit which is available to me. And once the conditions remain satisfied, that provisional credit becomes final credit and I can use it for the discharge of my liability. Then there are rules 36 to 45. They are the procedure which is to be followed. Particularly 42 and 43 are very important, which we'll be discussing today. And maybe I refer rest of the rules as a passing reference, but because in this 2-hour seminar where 1.5 hours is only for discussion, I'm sure we will not get time to deal with the rules in detail. What are the component of credit? They remains the same, which were traditionally there in the SENVET. That is input, service and capital goods. Now, practically, if you look at the definition of these three terms, goods means anything which has been capitalized becomes capital goods, not capitalized becomes goods. Credit is available to me in both the situation and the month of purchase, and the credit is 100% only. The distinction between capital goods and input is only for limited provisions of the law. For example, when I'm sending the goods to the job worker, then input must come back within 1 year, capital goods can come back after within 3 years. Or once I am disposing of any input which I have already purchased or capital goods, then at the time of disposal of that asset, if it's a capital goods, the life has been treated as 5 years. That is 5% credit for each quarter. I'll explain it with the set of an example. I purchased a machine for rupees 100. 18 rupees is the GST which is being paid. After 2 years, I am disposing of that machine. So I have paid 18 rupees. 18 rupees credit has been availed by me. 2 years have been passed. So 40% of the life of the capital goods is being to have been consumed. So that means 60% of 18 rupees I'm supposed to pay. But in case I'm able to sell the machine more than 60% value and the GST becomes liable to be paid more than the amount of reversal which is there on the basis of 5-year formula, I'm liable to pay the higher amount of tax. So that is the only limited purpose. Otherwise, there's no difference. And if you look at the definition of input service, it says any service. The only common thing is used or intended to be used. Why it is being used and why the term in the course of business is not there in the course of presence of business. These are two common features in all the three definitions, which we will discuss when we will discuss section 16. Input tax credit is only a technical term. Input tax means integrated tax. Tax CGST, IGST, UTGST, or any tax paid under the provisions of any state law, but does not include tax under composition levy. Now I am coming to the section 16, which is very, very important. It starts with the three words, every registered person. So first of all, the credit can be availed only by the registered person. Who is registered person? Who is registered under the provision of this act, section 25, but does not include a person who is having DIN number, which is only for the diplomatic mission. Now, who is liable to pay the tax? Taxable person. Taxable person means a person who is registered, who is liable to pay the tax, whether he is registered or not. Let us assume a trader who has crossed his exemption limit of 20 lakh, but he fails to get himself registered. Is he not liable to pay the tax? Yes, he is liable to pay the tax, but credit will be available only to the registered person, not to the taxable person. Meaning thereby, in terms of section 25, once you become liable to pay the tax, the government has given you a time of 30 days to make an application. You make an application for registration within 30 days, you get yourself registered, then you are liable to pay the tax from the day when your turnover exceeds 20 lakh and you are eligible for the credit which has become due to you after the date when you become liable to pay the tax. And of course, in section 18, whatever stock is there, you'll get credit for that also. But if I fail to seek registration within 30 days as prescribed in the provisions of the law, then I have double jeopardy. Kindly listen to it very carefully. double jeopardy in the sense I will be liable to pay the tax on my outward supplies, but till the date of registration, whatever purchases I have made, I will not be eligible for the credit. Credit will be available only from the day when I am registered. So meaning thereby, he is liable to pay the tax on the outward supply, is not eligible to take the credit of ITC paid on the inward supply. So there's a double jeopardy. And as I told you, the margin of profit is always less than the amount of credit. So practically, he is financially ruined, or practically he has incurred huge losses for that period. Just to give you an example, let us say I am a trader. My turnover of 20 lakh exceed on 5th of September. I didn't make the application. I did make the application on 12th of November, got myself registered on 15th. So from 5th September to 15th November, my turnover is 10 lakh. I'm liable to pay tax. 18% on 10 lakh, 1,80,000. But I am not entitled to the credit of the purchases made for this period. So if 8 lakh material, which is being sold for 10 lakh, is being purchased, then 8 lakh into 18%, that means 14,40,000 is the credit which I have lost. Do you think my margin is 14,40,000 on the business of that 10 lakh? So that is the point I want to make. The second is applicable only to the registered person. And subject to the condition and restriction, as may be specified in the manner under Section 49, we have already discussed about that. That talked about how the payment is to be made. IGST can be used only for the discharge of SGST, CGST. And corresponding SGST cannot be used for the discharge of CGST, and CGST and SGST are state specific. Be entitled to take credit of input tax charged. The word charged is very important, not chargeable. This gives me support when I was discussing with you, classification cannot be challenged in the hands of the recipient. It clearly says, if you have charged me the tax at a higher rate, then it was chargeable or leviable. Even then, I'm entitled to take credit of the amount which is being charged on the invoice. It is not chargeable. Which are used or intended to be used, as I told you, the purpose is to verify each and every transaction. Your stock record, closing stock, the tax element is being financed by you. You have not made payment to the supplier, kindly try to appreciate. You had purchased a material of rupees 100, which is lying in stock, 18 rupees the GST. You have not made payment of tax or value of supplies to the supplier. You can make payment within 180 days. Still, you are being allowed a credit of 18 rupees. So that means that stock, to the extent of input tax credit, has been financed by the department. Now, all the subject matter, input service and capital goods, is to be used in the course, and the conjunction or before furtherance of his business clearly says it has to be read like that input service and capital goods has to be used in the course of business, or these inputs etc. is to be used for the furtherance of business. Both way you are eligible for the credit. One-to-one correlation was not required even in the past, but now it is not linked with the taxable event, which we have already discussed in detail earlier. Now I'll give you certain examples. I am a trader. I am having 3 showrooms in Delhi. I want to open the 4th one. I am making taxable supplies only from the 3. And then I am establishing my 4th outlet, which I have taken on rent, on which I have paid GST on the rental. It is being furnished. Maybe the services or the supplies which falls under works contract is a block credit. But if I buy the AC, furniture, etc., they are all eligible for the credit. If that being so, I am eligible to claim the credit of tax paid on the supplies used for the making of new showroom, though there is no revenue coming from that. The revenue is only from the existing 4 showroom. So it is in the furtherance of business, because that showroom is for the furtherance of business. Earlier on, there used to be a lot of litigation on this. And the department says that it has to be used for the provision of output service. Once the showroom itself is not clear, let us say the office of a chartered accountant is not clear, how can he make supplies from there? But now that is not the case. Even in the case of chartered accountants, if I'm having an office in Rajouri Garden, Delhi, and my practice is doing well, I want to open an office in Gurgaon, I take the place on rent, and then I give a contract for furnishing, etc. Whatever tax I pay, I can use that tax for the discharge of my liability, which I am creating by providing services from my Rajouri Garden office. Now, I get support from Section 2, Clause 17 of CGX Act also, which deals with the definition of business. It provides that business includes supply or acquisition of goods, including capital goods and services, in connection with the commencement or closure of business. Even the activities with the commencement of business is there. So even if I want to enter into a new line of business, another interesting aspect can be, now we are going through Corona, lot of pharma company are trying to make a vaccine to cure this Corona. They are spending crores of rupees on the research and development. So in my humble opinion, some of them may be successful making the vaccine, some of them may not be successful. But in both the cases, in my humble opinion, they shall be entitled to claim the credit for all the supplies used in the research and development, because they have been used in the furtherance of business. Those who have been able to develop the vaccine, certainly they will earn a lot of money, so that credit will be accepted there. The government will also earn a lot of money. And those pharma companies also, where they have not been able to develop the vaccine, even then it is not going to make any difference. They can adjust this supply, this GST paid on the research and development activity against their existing business of selling the pharma which they develop and which they engage into during the period of Corona or even otherwise. So this credit shall be credited to the electronic credit ledger. That was the mechanism which was envisaged at the initial stage. And the language was, the credit will come fully. Whatever credit is not eligible, you will add to your output tax liability and discharge along with the payment of interest. Now, this is the most important section, and it is a non-obstruent clause, notwithstanding anything contained in this section, the whole section. You say, whatever has been stated in 16.1, humne jo marzi padha ho, it has to be used in the course of furtherance of business, credit shall not be available if these conditions are not being satisfied. What are those conditions? These are four conditions which has to be satisfied cumulatively. One, or the first condition, is that he is in possession of a tax invoice or a debit note or any other duty paying document as prescribed in Rule 36, which can be a document issued by the input service distributor, which can be a document issued by a distinct person of the same PAN on cross charge, which can be a custom duty bill of entry, which can be an invoice by the ISD distributor. So any document which is specified therein, you should have that document. But this is not conclusive. Having an invoice does not mean you are eligible for the credit. You have to satisfy other three conditions also. And the second condition, which we'll discuss, will be very, very important, that you must have received the goods or services. Then again, that document must be issued by a registered person under Section 25. We have already discussed that this credit mechanism is applicable only in the case of registered persons. Now he must have received. So that means only invoice is not there. You have to prove that you have received the goods and services of both. Most of the arrests which has been made in the country, I'm sure if you count the figures, which can go into thousands, then more than 95% arrests are being used, being made for the non-compliance of this condition only. Bogus invoices, the only allegation is either you have sold the goods without invoices or you have received the goods without, only on the paper, that is, invoices are there, you have not physically received the goods. The department has served another useful purpose by having this clause, and that clause is, in case you are making payment to the supplier of service in advance, along with GST. Still, you cannot claim the credit till you receive the services, because then this condition is not being satisfied. I'll give you an example. There is one very famous professional, a chartered accountant, who is a known personality. You want him to contest his case. He says, if you want me to contest your case, this may come in the tribunal after 6 months. You have to pay me the fees in advance. You pay the fees in advance, they issue the invoice also. Invoice of rupees 100 issued by that chartered accountant, 18 rupees GST is being charged. As a recipient, can you claim the credit? But the services are not yet to be provided. Services are yet to be provided and they have not been received by you. You cannot. Now the question comes, how one can satisfy this condition? So far as goods are concerned, you need to maintain detailed accounting and stock records. Meaning thereby, you should have a proper invoice. You should have proper e-way bill. In stock record, it is being shown as the inward entry. Then it is being issued for the production process. And then it forms part of the production and ultimately form part of the finished product. Or if it is being sold per se, then the invoice for the sale of that goods are. The problem comes in the case of services where it is very difficult to prove. So in the case of services, you must have an invoice. He is registered. Kindly make sure payment must be made through banking channel. All the communication or the agreement which you have entered with the supplier must be placed on record. In case an agreement is there, an agreement is not there, then certain mails you must have exchanged with the supplier of service, then those mails should be preserved. So a detailed record should be maintained to prove that you have received the goods or services or both. Then comes, friends, an explanation. How I have received the goods. Sometimes, as a manufacturer, I say, you kindly supply me the goods, but delivery should be given at the place of the job worker, which is being allowed in terms of Section 143. The receipt of goods by the job worker on behalf of the principal is also being treated as a deemed receipt of goods. And similar is the situation with regard to services also. Of course, the provision with regard to service has been introduced subsequently. I don't remember the date, but it was not there on 1st July 2017 when the law was introduced. Now I'm coming to third condition, which is there in Section 16, Subsection 2. It is very important condition and has been a subject matter of litigation in the past also, and it will continue to be taxed, continue to be debated in the times to come also. Condition is that the tax charge in respect of the supplies for which you intend to claim the credit, that tax must have been paid to the government by the supplier of goods. Now the question comes, as a recipient, how can I ensure that my supplier has made payment of tax? Is it in my hands? I can at the most ensure he is filing his 3B. If he is filing his 3B incorrectly and he has not paid the tax or manipulated his 3B, claimed the credit more than what he was liable to pay, how can I ensure? Because once he is making the payment, he is making the payment in one challan, and that challan is also being made after adjusting the ITC. For example, a person who is having a turnover of 1 lakh in a month may pay only 2,000 to the government, because the output tax liability may be 18,000, 16,000 is the credit available to him. Whereas the credit of 1 lakh, that is 18,000, must have been claimed by 8 to 10 people. If that being so, how can one say this 2,000 payment made on behalf of everyone who has made purchases from him? This matter is being disputed and litigated in the past also. And we have seen in the sale tax regime, there was number of judgment which says buying dealer cannot be penalized for the fault committed by the selling dealer. One of the leading judgment was Chunilal Prasad Dilal. Similarly, in VAT law, when this condition was being introduced, Mumbai High Court has given a decision in favor of the revenue, But Delhi High Court, in the case of Arise India Limited, has stated you cannot deny the credit to the buying dealer, in spite of the fact this condition is laid down in the law. Very recently, Jharkhand High Court has also stated so. But we all know under Article 141 of the Constitution, if a judgment is being given by the Honorable Supreme Court, that is as good as the law laid down by the parliamentarian or by the legislature. But Arise India, though it is being confirmed by Supreme Court, but not by passing a detailed and reasoned order, they have rejected the SLP filed by the revenue in summarily manner. So this judgment does not get benefit of Article 141 of the Constitution, in my humble opinion. Bombay High Court is in favor of the revenue. In the case of VAT law, in GST law, it is liable to be contested. So my humble submission is, we need to be very, very careful till it is being struck down. We try to have KYC of our suppliers, make sure that they are filing their return at least. Because once I'll be able to prove to the court can also take the stand that vigilant court help only the vigilant taxpayer. You should have taken care that he was registered during that point of time. You had made payment through banking channel. So all those precautions need to be taken. Finally, what will be the outcome? Court will finally decide. And the fourth condition is I must have furnished my return. Then the first proviso say that in case the goods are being dispatched in lots or installment, either it is CKD or maybe SKD, or I am seeking 10 ton of cement which has to be supplied to me 2 ton every week, and those installments are coming. So law says you have to raise the tax invoice with the first lot itself. Let us say from April, if that installment has to come in 5 months, and finally it will come to me in next month, second quarter, second week. So I will be eligible to the credit only when the last lot or installment is being received by me. Second proviso. This is really a very important proviso, and my chartered accountant brothers who are doing the audit of their client, maybe under Companies Act, maybe under income tax, and then they are doing GST audit also, they are finding very difficult how to comply with this. So I would like to deal with this proviso in slight detail. As per this provision, it says if the recipient fails to pay to the supplier the amount towards the value of supply along with tax payable within 180 days, then he has to reverse the credit in the month in which 180 days expires. And he shall be entitled to claim the credit in the month in which he will make the payment of value of supply and service tax thereon. And once he is entitled to claim the credit subsequently, then even the time limit, which we'll discuss when we'll discuss 16.4, shall not apply as prescribed in 16.4. Meaning thereby, agar kisi aadmi se maine supply li 100 rupaye ki, 18 rupaye us pe tax hai, 118, aur maine usko 59 rupees ki payment kar di, then I am supposed to take credit of 9 rupees only, and 9 rupees credit will be available to me in the month in which the credit will have, in this 59 rupees will be paid by me to the supplier. So this is what this slide says. Now we are the issues which are concerning with. We have seen that payment has to be made within 180 days from the date of invoice. Nothing to say from the date of supply of goods or services. If we talk about a situation when the goods are received in installment in 3 months, the invoice has been issued in the first month itself. So I am only getting 180 days from the date of original invoice, not from the date of receipt of the last installment of the goods. Secondly, in the case of services, I can issue the invoice within 30 days from the provision of service. Let us say the service is completed on 28th of December. I can raise the invoice by 21st of January. So on which date I will issue the invoice? Though I might have received the service earlier, I have to calculate 180 days from that date. So receipt of goods and service has got nothing to do with it. It is only the date of invoice, which is important for the purpose of calculating the monetary. Secondly, the department, though tried to administer the whole law through the computer, but so far as this provision is concerned, it is a self-disciplined mechanism and does not have any check and balances on the portal. You have to see in your own books of accounts when the amount is becoming due, and if you feel it has, I have not made the payment, it has become 180 days has been lapsed, then voluntarily you have to do. Failing which, in case you don't do it and the department find it subsequent to that, then of course you have to face the music. You have to pay not only the tax but interest and penalties also. In any case, interest has to be paid when I am reversing the credit for 6 months. But in case I don't reverse the credit and it's been caught by the department after 3 years, then the interest for the 3 years is to be paid. Next is, I am talking about one very important and famous judgment of B.C. Srinivas Shetty, wherein they say if the calculation mechanism is not being provided in the law, then those provisions cannot be held to be valid. They are all ultra vires. And we have seen in service tax also, L&T was contract service. Even Suresh Kumar Bansal, Delhi High Court, take the same stand in the case of builders, in the case of Suresh Kumar Bansal case, in the case of developer services. Now, as the original scheme says, credit has to come to your credit ledger automatically. That scheme is not being made applicable. Can I say you cannot deny my credit because the mechanism wherein credit was supposed to enter to my credit ledger, I was to calculate, which is not eligible to me, and then I was supposed to add that liability in my output tax liability and discharge it. Once that mechanism is not in place, am I liable to pay the tax on that? So according to me, taking such an enterprising view, I will never suggest, but yes, those who want to litigate, they can take that stand also, and they claim credit as per their books of accounts. Then comes proportionate credit permissible in case of part payment. I have already given you the example also. Then law says that the month in which 180 days expire, you have to reverse the credit, add to your tax liability, pay the same along with the interest. Now the question is, what is the rate of interest? Rate of interest as specified in the section 50. Now 50 subsection 1 says you are liable to pay interest at 18%. Subsection 3 says you are liable to pay interest at 24%. And this limit of the interest rate of 24% shall apply when the credit is being taken undue or excess claim of credit. Can you say by claiming the credit in the month when the invoice was being received, it was the excess claim of credit? No, it was not undue claim of credit also. I was entitled for the same at that point of time. I could not make the payment within 180 days because of financial reasons or because of dispute with the supplier or because of any reason. My humble submission is it will not fall under 24% interest. Interest shall be leviable only at 18%. Now, for which period interest is to be paid? Is it to be calculated from the date of invoice? No. In my humble opinion, interest is compensatory in nature. Once you are entitled for any credit and you claimed it, absolutely interest doesn't become due. Interest will become due for the liquidity of loss which is being suffered by the revenue. Let us say invoice was in the month of February. I used that credit in the month of April. In the meanwhile, that was lying in my credit ledger only. So obviously, the government was not likely to get the payment in cash. So I'm liable to pay the interest in the month in which I have used it for the discharge of my liability till the date of payment. So it may not be 180 days, it may be 60 days, it may be 80 days, it may be 90 days, depending upon the facts of the case. So the only thing is when I was liable to make the payment in cash to the interest, in cash to the department, from that date till the date of payment, I am supposed to pay the interest. Now it says fails to pay to the supplier. Whether the payment cannot be made in kind or by making a book entry. We being chartered accountants, we are expert in manipulating the accounts. First of all, I'll take this issue in two parts. In kind. in kind, I think there is no problem. I am a chartered accountant doing audit of a company who is a trader of, let us say, bikes. My fees is 1 lakh rupees. 1 lakh rupees is the cost of bike. So he gives me the bike rather than in cash. I think it is duly discharged of the liability. I have to debit to the fixed assets account and credit to my debtor account, because I am not receiving the payment in cash. Bank will not be debited. The fixed asset which will be debited. To that extent, I think there is no problem and I can pay the amount. Second is by passing the book entry. Can I say, I have given a loan of 1 lakh to him and creditor is being finished. Let us say I have made a sale of bike to a Mr. A for 1 lakh rupees. 18,000 is the GST. So he has not made the payment. I am saying I am giving you a loan of 1,18,000. I show the amount of loan and debtor is being realized. By passing that entry, can I circumvent this condition? I think it is not so easy. I'll deal another situation and then I'll answer it also. There can be a situation where I am not finding a customer. I am a manufacturer of heavy machine. In order to find the customer, I say, okay, I am willing to give you the machine. You make the payment in 24 installments. So whether permitting him to make payment in 24 installments, can I circumvent this 180 days? According to my understanding, any arrangement between two parties which goes against the provisions of law is not a valid agreement. It is a camouflage or a colorable device to avoid the payment of tax. So you cannot do that. Yes, in case you are really interested in allowing 24 months to your customer, then the route which you should follow, according to me, should be that you grant a loan to him, either from that company or some other company. Execution of the document is there. There should be some rate of interest, market rate of interest. And then from that loan account, that payment is being made on account of the supplier. And that loan is outstanding against the supplier. By doing so, I think we can circumvent this provision, but not otherwise, not in every case. Then comes, for example, now we are going into this corona period, we are being locked down. Whether in calculating this 180 days, the period of lockdown shall be included or should not be included? Answer can be both ways. There are specific notifications now giving relief in certain concessionals. There are general notification also, anything which become due between this and this date, that is 28th of March till 29th of June, the due date will be 30th June. Similarly, Supreme Court has also given a judgment which says in case the due date files between these 2 days, it gets extended to this particular period. So, according to my understanding, it should get extended because I have to make the payment from my business receipt when the business itself is closed down. Post Majra clause is applicable. So, this 180 days maybe I need to be extended. Then another important aspect I am going to discuss with you, and this question is being asked to me by number of chartered accountants. Sir, I am doing an audit, 9C is there, he has not made the payment which he was supposed to make payment in the month of February, but in the next financial year, in August, he has made the payment. So now, how do I report this transaction? Should he reverse the credit right now because he will be eligible only in the month of August? But in the month of August, he has already made the payment, is eligible, that eligibility has become. So am I liable to pay the interest only? So that is very tricky situation. In this situation, my suggestion will be, because the condition of the law is not being complied with, he was supposed to reverse the credit in the month in which the 180 day period has expired. He has not done so. So the tax liability is there. And this liability cannot be used by the liability which arises in the subsequent month. So in my humble opinion, it should not be done. But in any case, in case you want to do it, because there's a certain article also, it's a revenue neutral situation and all that, I don't subscribe to that view, but there can be different views, absolutely no problem. So my humble suggestion in that scenario is, you must mention that non-compliance by the dealer in your report. Now this provision of 180 days payment does not apply, number one, in the case of reverse charge mechanism, because the tax has to be paid by me only, and in the case of transaction between two distinct persons having the same PAN number. Now, friends, coming to section 16, subclause 3, which is absolutely on the line of earlier law, doesn't require any much deliberation. It says if you have paid any tax on the capital goods or plant and machinery, and you intend to claim the credit for that in your while discharging your liability, certainly you cannot capitalize it for the purpose of claiming depreciation. That means dual benefit is not being allowed. So we all understand that. I'm not deliberating much on that. I'm moving to the time limit 16.4. As I told you, the 16.4 is not applicable when I have received the invoice, but I have to reverse the credit because of non-payment. And if that payment is being made subsequent to the time limit as prescribed in section 16.4, I shall be eligible for the credit. So to that extent, it is very clear. Now the question is, what is the time period by which I am eligible to claim the credit? That time period has been specified. 17-18 was the exceptional year, so there is a different provision being added. But normally it is due date of filing of return for the month of September or the actual date of filing of return, whichever is earlier. So the annual return is liable to be filed by 31st December and the September return is liable to be filed by 20th October. So by and large, it is 20th October by which I can claim the credit. But earlier on, that means that debit note or invoice belonging to 17-18, I am eligible to take the credit by 31st March 2019. And if I take normal years, which are likely to be there in the periods to come, then let us say 18-19, if it is the credit, then by 20th of October 2019, I am eligible to claim the credit thereof. So in case there is an invoice of 18-19 in the month of March, for which I can claim the credit by 20th October, but there is a debit note, let us say in the month of November, there has been a dispute in the value between the supplier and the recipient, and somehow that dispute got resolved after 20th October. Then even though I have discharged the tax liability on the basis of debit note, which I have raised to the recipient, but then recipient was not eligible to claim the credit because that debit note belongs to the period of 18-19 and the maximum date of claiming the credit was 20th October. In this finance bill, now the amendment has already been made and it is being, the date of debit note is being delinked from the date of invoice. Meaning thereby the debit note is coming in financial year 19-20, he can claim the credit by 20th day of October 2020, not 2019. So it's a good amendment, but the fact is, though it is being amended, but yet it is not being notified. Unlike earlier provision, when the bill is enacted, things are being notified, it becomes an act, it becomes into operation. But in the case of GST, it is not so. First of all, it has to be enacted, then the similar enactment has to be passed by all the states, and then it has to be notified. We know from our experience that the amendment of 18 came into operation in 19, and some of the amendments which have been already made in 19, they have not come into operation till date. Now, another important thing, friends, whether the 16.4 time limit will apply, is it not ultra vires to the provision of section 16.1 and 16.2? Why I am saying so? When I was reading section 16.2, I said it is a non-obstant clause, and non-obstant clause with regard to the whole section 16. So that means 16.1, there is eligibility. 16.2, non-obstant clause to all the provisions, all the subclauses of this section. If those four conditions being satisfied, then whether this time limit is goes beyond the statutory time limit prescribed under the law. Of course, people are innovative and they have found out this drafting error. And whatever information I had, this provision is being challenged in Delhi High Court also. And none other than STAR, Society for Tax Analysis and Research. So they have also challenged this provision. But I will suggest all my professional colleagues not to become so enterprising and try to follow this limit in case that judgment goes against us or it, the section itself, let us say section 16 is amended retrospectively by saying if this is not withstanding only to section 16.1 and not to 16.4, then there can be an issue. So take a conservative view and follow this limit. Now I am coming to the another important section, that is section 17. Section 17 talk about the apportionment of input tax credit. Let us say I am a chartered accountant. All my services are taxable. I don't have income from any other source. Then absolutely there is no problem. I am entitled for the full tax credit. The problem comes when I am a chartered accountant, I am a dealer in shares, securities, which are not being covered in the definition of goods itself. Forget about the applicability of the charging section. Once it is not the subject matter of taxation at all, there is no liability. If I am doing this, then can I claim the full credit? Again, I am repeating because there is a call which is disturbing me. Just to recapitulate, if I am providing all taxable supplies, absolutely no problem. But if I am carrying out shares and then I am paying service tax to all the supplier of services, and assuming for making investment in shares, I am also taking the service of an investment consultant who has raised the invoice to me. Am I supposed to reverse that credit? Second issue is, there may be certain exempted services and I am paying tax on input and input services which are being used exclusively for exempted supplies. Whether I am supposed to reverse the credit. Now we will read these sections as well as rule 42 and 43 to finalize or to find out what is the legal implication, what is the legal understanding of these two sections. Where the goods or services are both are used by the registered person partly for the purpose of any business and partly for other purposes, the amount of credit shall be restricted to so much of the input tax as is attributable to the purpose of business. Absolutely correct. They say in case you are using goods and services both for the purpose of business and other than business, then supplies attributable to other than business, you are not entitled for the credit. Look at the language once again and now read it the way I am suggesting it. Is it referring to the common services or exempted services used exclusively for the exempted supply or anything which is used which are neither a supply, either it is a Schedule 3 item or it is a security, it applies to that also. Where the goods or services are both are used by the registered person partly for the purpose of any business, partly for other purpose. So is it talking about a common services? In my humble understanding, this may be one of the view. May not be one of the view, that is another issue, but one of the interpretation which is coming from this language is very clear that it talks about the common services. If that being so, this apportionment has to be done of the common services. The services used exclusively for exempted supply, there is no such provision. Of course, it is very illogical. But in the absence of a provision, because law and equity doesn't go hand in hand, we have seen the time when the cycle was supposed to be taxed at 12% in Delhi and Maruti was liable to be taxed at 6%. Even in GST regime, gold biscuit is liable to be taxed at 3% and biscuit which are for human consumption are liable to be taxed at a much higher rate, 12%. Or maybe in some cases 18%. So it says apportionment is to be done when these supplies have been used partly for business and partly for other than business purposes, according to me, shall apply only to the common service. Then comes where the goods and services are used by the registered person partly for effecting taxable supply and exempted supply. Now, taxable supply includes zero rated supply. Absolutely no problem. And with regard to the language also, the same issue, whether it talks about the common services. And then exempted services, which has a different meaning so far as 17(3) is concerned, will come a bit later because it says, but here the exempted services means the definition given under section 247, which is clearly says exempt supply is a supply which is not liable to be taxed, nil rate of tax or non-taxable supply. But whatever is being added for the purpose of 17(3), can that definition of exempted supply, exempted service can apply here as well? That is the question which I'm posing to my professional brother. They can answer it themselves and they can take their own view. According to my humble understanding, it is not. 17(3). Now, the question comes, if I take a very enterprising view based on my own explanation, which I have given it to you, then the question comes, if these provisions are being amended retrospectively, what will be the implication? We have seen wherever the government intend to collect a tax and if there is a drafting error, then the law is being amended retrospectively to ensure that there is no loss of revenue. One of such example is in the case of renting of immovable property, where we have seen Delhi High Court in the case of Home Solution said renting per se is not taxable. Even Mumbai High Court gave a judgment, the matter went to Supreme Court. And before these courts could take any action on that, this definition was amended by the Finance Act 2010 with effect from 1st June 2017 to include not only renting per se, but services in relation to renting also. So if these, first of all, some of you may differ my interpretation of 17(1) and 2. Those who agree, they should also look into the aspect if tomorrow the government rectify or amend these definitions retrospectively or by issuing an order in removal or difficulty order case, then what will happen? So I will not suggest you to take you that an enterprising view, but yes, sometimes it really helps for the imposition of penalty. And once the ambiguity is there and I am claiming the credit, then penalty cannot be leviable, extended period cannot be invoked. For those purposes also we can use it. Similarly, we have seen in the case of commercial trading and coaching services also, when it became taxable from 1st July 2003, in 2007 the amendment came, what is the meaning of commercial training and coaching, to clarify. Training should be commercial, the institution need not be commercial. And that was also a retrospective amendment. But then there have been instances where the court has interpreted the law in favor of the SSE, and then number of SSEs have been benefited from the ambiguity prevailing in the law. For example, worst contract services when came into effect from 1st June 2007, L&T came in 2015, and those who are litigating the matter, the court was very clear this levy only from 1st June, so composite supply of material and contracts with regard to construction are not liable to be taxed at all. Whether the dispute was with regard to abatement, whether the dispute was with regard to SENVET, once that activity itself is not taxable, no demand. And lot of businessmen have been benefited from that proposition also. Similarly, we have seen Delhi High Court decision, Intercontinental, wherein Rule 5.1 of the point of taxation rule was struck down. Tax is not payable on reimbursement expenses. So that is being affirmed by the Supreme Court also. So we have been benefited by taking the advantage of wrong drafting. Similarly, there have been cases in the case of restaurant in Kerala. You all know, single member bench said service tax is not liable to restaurant services because 366(29) capital A subclause F, supply of food with or without provision of service, the whole amount is subject to tax under VAT. Mumbai High Court given a verdict in a different manner. Obviously, rest of the people have been paying tax. But Kerala restaurant people had never paid the tax. And then the matter went to the appeal to the double bench of the same High Court. Again, it was the same proposition. They say, we agree with the single bench observation and 360(29A. His interpretation is perfectly fine. So restaurant in Kerala has never discharged the liability. Similarly, in the case of free supply. So looking to all this scenario, in the case of Bhyana Builder, it is not liable to be taxed when the free supply has been given to the recipient. The department made amendment in the notification. Even then, they did not succeed. So where, to what extent we has to be enterprising in section 17.1 and 2 implementation? This I leave it to you. But wherever the credit is a huge amount, my suggestion will be claim the credit, don't utilize it for the purpose of making payment. There will be no interest liability. And in case the law doesn't get itself amended, you can avail it subsequent to that. That is my suggestion. Now, value of exempt supply under subsection 2 shall be such as may be prescribed and shall include supplies on which the recipient is liable to pay tax on the versa. This is only for the purpose of calculating the value of exempt supply. As I told you, 247 will apply when we look at the provision of 17.2, and when we calculate, let us say for the purpose of reversal, if I am having an activity of share broker, you can add it into the exempted supply. Once it is not a supply, still it can be added to it because of this provision. But this provision is limited only for the purpose of calculating the value of exempt supply for the purpose of apportionment of the credit, which can be only for the common services, in my humble opinion. This provision is already there. It was there in the service tax regime also. Banks, including NBFC, have been given an option either to apportion the credit on the basis of taxable and exempted supply, or they can claim the credit of 50%, which has due become due in the month, and rest of the 50 months that has to forego. Those who are engaged into the bank audit, they can listen to me carefully, because under GST law, now a lot of money is being paid by the branches or the circle of offices to the head office on cross charge invoicing. So whether cross charge invoicing, the limit of 50% shall also be applicable to there. I'll give you an example. Let us say there is a credit of 100 rupees in a branch. Out of that, 10 rupees tax has been paid to the regional office or the head office on cross charge invoices. 10 rupees is the credit which is not available because of block credit under section 17.5. And 10 rupees is the credit which they have used for non-business and personal purposes. Assuming exclusive supplies for exempted are also not liable to be allowed or credit is not permissible, then the calculation has to be done. 100 rupees minus block credit minus personal and non-business, 80 rupees. So 50% of that 40 rupees, and 10 rupees which he has paid to the regional office or head office will be fully available. So that means he can avail the credit of 50 rupees. So this is the only technical point which I want to make out. Otherwise, this provision was there, and those who are dealing with the financial receipts are fully conversant with this. Now, I'll draw your attention to the language of Rule 42 and 43. Rule 42, the input tax credit in respect of input or input services which attack the provision of subsection 1 and 2. So this rule will come into force only when they attack the provision of 1 and 2. And if we read 1 and 2 as only applicable for common services, then in spite of the fact, for the purpose of calculation from the total tax credit, I have to reduce exempted non-business block credit. And exclusively for taxable supplies, difference is the common credit which has to be apportioned. So this rule cannot go beyond this dictate. So this is my humble opinion. Similarly, when we go to 43 also, they also talk about the same kind of language. So with this, I'm concluding this discussion on this clause. Now we are moving to subsection 4, which is the most important thing looking to the language of section 16, subsection 1, because that provides credit on all input services and capital goods used or intended to be used in the course of furtherance of business, for which we already had a detailed discussion. Now 17.5, is again a notwithstanding clause. It says even if you are eligible for the credit in section 16 or 18, even then the credit shall not be available. And now there are A to H clauses. We'll go one by one. Motor vehicle for transportation of persons having approved seating capacity of not more than 30%. So first of all, it has to be a motor vehicle, which falls into the definition, which definition is very technical, having four wheel probability to do this. So three wheelers not be covered, two wheelers not being covered. So this clause will not apply to them. This clause will apply only to the vehicle designed to carry passengers up to 13%. So all cars, etc., buses, etc., will go out of this. Then there is an exception. That exception is if those supplies are being used for making further supply for transportation of passengers or for imparting training or driving motor vehicle. So credit shall be available in these three exceptional cases. So meaning thereby rent a cab operator or a transporter or a dealer of automobile certainly will get the credit. Then comes vessel and aircraft, except when they are used for making taxable supplies, as I told you, further supply of goods, transportation of passenger, imparting training for flying such aircraft. Aircraft is for aircraft, vessel is for the vessel. And then comes Roman II. That means either it is vessel, aircraft, or motor vehicle. Once they are used for the transportation of goods and the vehicle is also designed for the transportation of goods, the credit is not barred. So that means all truck, etc., once they are discharging liability at full rate of 12%, they are entitled for the credit. Then comes AB clause, which talk about services of general insurance services, repair and maintenance relating to motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft, as we have discussed earlier. So this restriction is also to the motor vehicle, which are being covered in the definition of motor vehicle, not three-wheeler, etc., not two-wheeler, etc., vessels and aircraft. If you are eligible for the credit for the motor vehicle and you fall in those exceptions like car dealer or otherwise, then these credits shall also be available to you. Am I clear? So not such a technical issue. So it is. Then we can go to clause B. The following supply of goods and services are both food and beverages, outdoor catering, beauty treatment, health services, cosmetic and plastic surgery, leasing, renting, hiring a motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft, referred to in clause so and so, except when used for the purpose specified therein, life insurance and health insurance. Except when used for the purposes specified therein. If I am using that services for the specific purposes, then only I am eligible for the credit. Otherwise, these credits being personal in nature, credit shall not be available. And what are the specified purposes? Input accredited inspector of such goods and services both shall be available where an inward supply of such goods and services is used by a registered for making an output taxable supply in the same category of goods or as a composite or mixed supply. Same. If I am a restaurant owner, I am getting food from somebody else who is doing catering for me, I am entitled for the credit. That supply may not be supply per se, but it can be a composite or mixed supply also. Membership of a club, health and fitness center not allowed under any circumstances. Travel benefit extended to employees. I think there has been an amendment in 2019 which I have missed. So now this clause is not correct according to my understanding. I'm really sorry. I might have taken a wrong presentation. After 2019, all these expenses are allowed if they have been mandated by law or they have been used for making further supply per se or as a composite or mixed supply. Then comes WAS contract, clause C. This WAS contract service, when supplied for construction of an immovable property, exception is plant and machinery, except when it is an input service for further supply of WAS contract. Meaning thereby, if I am a contractor, and I have engaged subcontractor for the supply of that good, certainly I am eligible for the credit. If I am a builder, I am constructing commercial properties, because in the case of residential, after 1st April 2019, now it is 5% or 1% for affordable housing and otherwise, and no credit is available. So this clause has got meaning now only for the commercial builders where they can claim the credit. Then comes second proposition where I try to become smart. I give a contract to the contractor to provide services in relation to the construction, whereas all the material has been purchased by me. Certainly, then it will not fall into the definition of WAS contract. WAS contract has been defined in Section 2, Subclause 119, which contains 13 activities: construction, erection, commissioning, installation, completion, fitting out, repair, maintenance, renovation, alteration, and building, fabrication, and modification thereof in relation to immovable property. So, if I am buying that material, given a contract for the service, even then I am not eligible for the credit. And then construction has been further defined, includes reconstruction, renovation, addition, alteration, repair, etc., to the extent of capitalization. So that means repair to the building, which is not being capitalized, credit is not available. So wherever they have been capitalized, the credit is not available except for plant and machinery. Absolutely no problem. We'll discuss plant and machinery in the next slide. So WAS contract services, wherein 13 activities, which I have stated in relation to immovable properties involved, credit is barred. But then Odisha High Court, in the case of Safari Retreats Private Limited, says a builder who is constructing the mall for the purpose of leasing it out and earning revenue on which GST has been discharged, because they are all commercial renting, shall be entitled to claim the credit in spite of this restriction being contained in Section 17, Subsection 5. One thing which we really need to understand as a professional, that they have not held that it is ultra vires or unconstitutional or ultra vires to any particular section or to the Act or any other thing. No. They say on the principle of parity, once a builder is selling a flat to the intending buyer of the flat before the completion certificate, and he is making payment of tax to the construction of for the construction to the contractor, certainly he is entitled for the credit. But why this chain is being broken once that premises is being used for the purpose of letting out? And the whole scheme of the Act is to avoid the cascading effect. It may be a good judgment, it may not be a good judgment, but as of now, this judgment is there. So if my contractor is in the state of Odisha, which has got a territorial jurisdiction, and Odisha High Court judgment is binding on that territory, am I liable to pay the tax? Am I not entitled for the credit? I must take the credit. Now you can say, Mr. Batra, this judgment, there is already an appeal filed by the revenue in the Supreme Court, which has been accepted. Then what? No order for the stay of the operation of this High Court judgment has been passed. The appeal has been admitted, notice has been issued. So this order is not being stayed. Operation of this order is not being stayed. So in my humble opinion, all the contractors in the state of Odisha can take advantage of it. Not only that, friends, my further observation is, because WAS contract is a service, and if I am located in Delhi, I may have project in Odisha, I may not get myself registered in Odisha and still discharge the liability under GST by ignoring the local CGST, SGST, which I have paid while procuring goods and services in the state of Odisha. Because according to me, compliance cost is much more as compared to the loss of credit. Now, looking to this particular judgment, my suggestion to all those contractors who are having their site in Odisha to get themselves registered in Odisha. Because by doing so, it is a distinct person under Section 25, and that office can take advantage of this Odisha High Court judgment. Actually, that is another part of it. Now, the third part comes. If I am a contractor in Delhi, Maharashtra, or anywhere within India, outside the state of Odisha, what should be my stand? My question is, if you are into residential construction contract started after 1st April 2019, no issue, you are not eligible for the credit at all. If we talk about commercial contract, and they are likely to take a lot more time, my humble submission is, one should claim the credit. Suppose tomorrow 16-4 held to be constitutional or some amendment is being made. And if that being so, then I will not be able to claim that credit the subsequent year. in case you don't want to take any risk, certainly take the credit, debit to the tax credit account in your books of accounts and carry it forward, because then it is indefeasible. And once you are not utilizing it, there's no question of interest liability also. And looking to the fact that in the case of a builder industry, the credit is already on the very higher side. And in case you had cost of land very less, let us say 10% or 20%, and then 80% construction on which you are able to claim the credit more than 12%, then you did not take that chance. But there can be a situation where a contractor is executing a contract where the cost of land is too high. Let us say 60%, 70%. Then the construction will be 15 to 20, rest will be interest, another margin. So on 15 to 20, you will have only a credit of 3 to 4 rupees. In those cases, my suggestion is you can claim the credit. Maybe if you are financially very tight and you are getting the borrowed funds at a rate of interest more than 18%, then you can use that credit also. Because ultimately, you are paying less than the interest which you are liable to pay otherwise in the market, and you are doesn't have financial resources, penalty cannot be levied because the judgment is in our favor. But keep a track on the development in this regard. The moment this judgment is being approved or disapproved, then accordingly take action by reversing the credit or finalize your accounts by utilizing that credit. Then, friends, we are coming to clause E. Goods or services are both on which tax are paid. The section 10, no problem. Everybody knows composition dealer, because 16(1) says every registered person is eligible for the credit. Composition dealer is also registered, so they have put up a clause in 17(5) in case you are receiving supplies from. But again, I will like to make it once again clear: if you are making the payment under the reverse charge 9394, 53, or 54. Certainly, you are eligible for that credit if you are otherwise eligible. Composition dealer charging you tax, there is no question of any claim of credit. It cannot show that amount in the invoice. You have not paid the tax. You have availed services. No issue. But in case you are paying the tax under RCM, either it is concessional rate of tax. I have already repeated that. Once again, for the sake of repetition, I would like to say you are eligible for that credit. Then comes goods and services both received by a non-resident taxable person except on goods imported by him. Again, as I told you, every registered person is entitled for the credit, so they want to put up a restriction on the non-resident taxable person. They have put up that condition. Then goods and services used for personal consumption, obviously not available. The mechanism is already there in Rule 42. Now I am coming to the last clause, last important clause. There are other clauses also. Goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off, or conjunction or is being used, disposed of by way of gift or present. So I would like to discuss this clause by dividing into three parts. One is goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off, I am leaving for the time being. Then disposed of by way of gift or disposed of by way of present. So first issue. Goods lost, stolen, destroyed. All the three words, lost, stolen, destroyed, were used in DVAT Act also, Rule 7, Subclause 3. I don't know about the other VAT law, where the credit was not available. So here they say, goods lost, unnatural loss, stolen, unnatural loss, destroyed, unnatural loss, and written off. My first question is, if there is a loss because of natural process, whether I am supposed to reverse the credit. I'll take an example. There may be a chemist whose medicine has become expired. There may be certain chemical. I buy 100 kg of chemical. There's an evaporation process and I'm able to sell only 99 liter. Will I be supposed to reverse the credit? I am dealing in kriyana goods. I'm having certain pickles, etc., which also become time-barred after 3 months, 6 months. And then there is a strict law. If I sell it, I can be imprisoned under CRPC also. So I destroy those goods. Can I be liable to reverse the credit with regard to those goods also? In my humble opinion, no. They're all unnatural things. And certainly, written off word is being used subsequent to that and applying the principle of interpretation, either nocitis sucessis or adjacent generic, this written off will take its color from goods lost, stolen, and destroyed. So first of all, if those goods have been lost because of natural process, evaporation, time barred, expiry, etc., certainly I am not liable to reverse that credit. Written off is only will take its color. This clause is applicable only to the goods and not to the services. This is also very important. Then comes disposed of by way of gift. What is gift? Gift is a voluntary payment, maybe gratuitous, maybe you can say for any charity purpose, without expecting any benefit, consideration on any kind of return. So friends, if it is a gift, certainly I am supposed to reverse the credit. But if it is a gift to a related person, then what is the proposition? I'll give you an example. I am a dealer of stationery. I had a pen which I purchased for rupees 100 in the month of April. In the month of July, there's a birthday of my son. I give that pen to my son on that birthday. Now, it is certainly a gift. I am not expecting anything from my son. Am I liable to reverse the credit or is it deeming supply? Because my charging section read with schedule 1 says if you are making a supply and that is without consideration and the transaction is between two related persons, even then it can be considered as a supply. So whether supply of that pen to my son is a deemed supply read with charging section with section 7 read with schedule 1 or I have to reverse the credit. So I have given you a very small example. There can be a huge amount involved in this. Now if I talk financially, for the time being, leave it legally. If I talk about the financial implication of this, I can say if I reverse the credit, I have to reverse it on 100 rupees. 18 rupees is the tax. So my reversal is 18 rupees. And even if I'm reversing in the month of July, when my son's birthday is there, so for the 3 months, I have to pay the interest of 18%, which works out to be, let us say, for easy calculation, 4 rupees. So I'm supposed to pay 18 rupees as tax and 4 rupees interest, 22 rupees. If I'm selling that pen, let us say at 150 to my client, then if it has been considered as a deeming supply, then fair market value on 150, I'm liable to pay 27. Can I choose a financial mechanism which is suitable to me? And this problem is further mystified and complicated by the department in their frequently asked questions. They say you can go one of these, either you can discharge the liability or you can reverse the credit. This is in the case of banking financial services where they have been answering certain questions. FAQ does not have any legal sanctity, I understand that. But whatever you want to do, according to me, it is a deemed supply and supply comes first, then comes the question of credit. I'm liable to pay 27. But yes, whatever view you take, if financially it doesn't match with the government will certainly like to litigate. If you say it's a supply, they will say reversal would have been required along with interest. And if you say it's a reversal, they will say supply. So this kind of litigation cannot be avoided, but this is what it is. Then comes whether giving an item as free. For example, I'm buying 2 shirts, then 1 undergarment is free. Am I supposed to reverse the credit on the undergarment? As I told you, gift means any payment voluntarily, gratuitously, because of charity and all that. But in this case, it is a contractual obligation. If I buy the 2 pants, then only I am entitled, 2 shirts, then only I am entitled for the undergarment, which is a free one. So it is not free. Technically, you are charging a consolidated price for all the 3. In my opinion, credit is not to be reversed. Then comes a lot of expenditure incurred by these companies on their Diwali or New Year Eve. So far as Diwali is concerned, so far as promotional items are there, diary, calendars, keychains. According to me, they are not free. Once you are giving a calendar to Mr. Batra, who is using that calendar in his office, people are coming, looking at that calendar, getting a marketing advantage. In my humble opinion, because it is a promotional item where you get an advantage by way of promotion. Of course, I am not under legal obligation to provide you promotional services, but you are giving me a gift and you are getting that advantage. Somehow, I feel that there is a good case to contest with and we are likely to get the credit. Then question comes, if I am distributing sweet or dry fruit on that occasion, I say that that box contains my name or the company's name. So I think then I am stretching the argument too far. Once I consume the dry fruit or sweets, I don't think I am doing any marketing for the company. So in that case, the credit may not be allowed to you. Then comes disposal by way of free sample. Certainly, there is no doubt about that. Free samples are the mini-usual sample in which the product I am dealing with. It is very common in pharma and cosmetic industry. Friends, absolutely no problem. I can reverse the credit. The only thing I want to emphasize here is, once you are distributing the sample, it should be done from the manufacturing base itself, from manufacturing registration. If my manufacturing is in Delhi, from Delhi itself. I may have other distinct offices in other state. I should not transfer the sample and distribute from there. Because once I distribute the sample from Delhi, and in Delhi, we all understand the value of raw material which goes into the manufacturing of 100 rupees medicine may be only 20 rupees. On 20 rupees, if 12% is the average rate of tax, 2 rupees 40 paisa is reversed. But if the same sample, I give it to my Bombay office and they distribute to the doctor, then the problem is huge, because the protection of second provisor to rule 28 is not available, because Bombay office is not likely to get the credit of the same. So that invoice value will not be accepted. Fair market value will be 100. On 100, the tax rate will be, let us assume, 18%. Then 18 rupees is the credit which I have to reverse, as compared to 2.4 rupees, which was on my input. So that policy you need to be take care of. Now look into the time constraint I am running. Then whatever tax you have paid in 74, 129 and 3074 is the section dealing with the issuance of show cause notice, where there is non-payment of tax, short payment of tax, erroneous claim of refund, or wrong claim of input tax credit, either availed or utilization. Then credit is not available. Let us say I have not charged any tax, show cause is there, now I am issuing a debit note for the tax. I am liable to pay the amount, certainly, but you are not liable. 129 deals with the conveyance, detention and seizure, and 130 is confiscation of goods. If I am paying any tax under these two sections, even that is not available for the credit. Then the government can prescribe the manner, and the manner is already there. We have discussed from 40 to 43. With this, I would like to conclude my discussion, because I promised my organizers, I will devote 15 times to the question answer session. And of course, this one slide I have forgotten to deal with. If you permit me, I can take 1 minute. For the purpose of WOS contract, the plant and machinery definition is apparatus, equipment and machinery. It must be falling there, used by the earth, by foundation or structural support. And then they say these three things are not included. The main query which normally comes in the trade is with regard to the lift in the commercial building. According to my understanding, it satisfies the definition of plant and machinery and you're eligible for the credit. With these words, I would like to thank my organizer for providing me this opportunity to share my views on this interesting topic of ITC. And now, over to organizers for question answers.
We are really thankful to you, sir, for your wonderful deliberation. And we have a lot of questions and we have tried to convert it into the list, basically, so that there are a lot of repetitive questions. So I have tried the level best. May I start, sir, with questions?
Please.
The first question is from C. Amandeep Singh Ji. He said, is there any difference between availment and utilization of ITC?
Yeah, there's a huge difference. Availment is a different activity. Once I have received the invoice, I don't expense or capitalize the amount of GST paid on that invoice. I will debit it to the input tax credit, which is a current asset in my financial books account. That is the availment. And let us say in that particular month, I don't have any liability, so I can carry it forward subsequently. Next month also, there is a liability of 5 rupees. And I had a credit of 10 rupees in my books of accounts. I can utilize that 5 rupees. 5 rupees is still being availed but not utilized, which will be carried forward. So till the time I am using that credit for the purpose of discharge of my tax liability except RCM, that is the point of utilization. Availment is a concept when you receive the invoice and you debit to the tax credit account in your books of accounts.
Sir, further, he stated that one of his SSC has wrongly claimed RTC through 3B, but not yet utilized for paying any liability, and that amount is still in its credit ledger. If they reverse now, do they need to pay interest as it is not utilized yet?
No interest is to be paid. There are a couple of judgments. I don't remember the citation, even one Supreme Court also, and then department circular is also there. No interest is to be paid. Pratibha Professor can also assist.
Thank you, sir. Sir, next question is through an example that if invoice date is 17 March 2020 and effective date of registration is 20th March 2020 and submitting, they are definitely going to submit their...
Sorry. Once again, you have to tell me 17th March is the date of the invoice.
Registration date is 20th March.
Registration date is 20th March. When he become liable to pay the tax?
Sir.
That is important. Kindly appreciate.
Yes, sir.
If I was liable to pay the tax, let us say the liability comes on 1st March, I make an application within 30 days on 13th March, and I get the invoice registered 20th March, then I am entitled for the credit on 17th March. But in case I am making my application for registration beyond 30 days from the date of liability, and the date of invoice is 17th March, then credit will not be available.
Sir, next is question from CA Sukhinder Manasji. Under section 31(3), a supplier get 30 days to issue revised invoice after getting registration. Why ITC for same period purchases not allowed under section 16?
It is not so. I have given an example also. Once again, I will give an example to make the issue very clear. Kindly listen to me very carefully. Let us say my liability becomes due because my taxable quantum exceed on 5th of March. I make an application within 30 days on 28th of March. I get the registration on 2nd of April. So I can revise the invoice from 5th of March to 2nd of April. But in case my liability starts from 5th of March, I make an application on 16th of April, then certainly because this application has been made beyond 30 days, I cannot revise my invoices and the whole credit is gone.
Okay. Sir, there's a one question of whether to invoice. Can we take it right now or?
Please.
Sir, in case of bill to ship to invoice, whether transporter need to carry bill issued by original recipient for his supply to the person to whom goods are being shipped?
Dekhiye, e-way bill is a mechanism to justify the movement of goods. If I am buying the goods from Mr. A and then I'm raising the invoice to Mr. A, but the goods are being delivered at the site of Mr. B. So whatever invoice I'm having at that point of time, that is what has been issued by the supplier. So the invoice which is to be given to the ultimate customer, I can carry that invoice. That is the reason that, because in that, kindly appreciate this, I'll give you an example. In this case, the main problem is, if I am buying a goods from Mr. A, who is in Gujarat, I am B in Delhi, and C is in, let us say, Maharashtra, where the goods are to be given. So I am buying the goods from Mr. A. So Mr. A is in Gujarat. Transporter will be of Gujarat only, and the goods has to be given to the Maharashtra. If e-way bill is being generated by transporter or by transporter, then obviously he will raise an invoice to me. The manufacturer in Gujarat will raise an invoice to me in Delhi and the goods will be dispatched to. So he has to carry an invoice wherein my name is there as consigner and the name of the recipient is there as a consignee. So he will carry that invoice. But in case I don't want my margin to be relieved to him, then I can raise the invoice. Then in that case, he can carry the invoice which I am issuing in the name of the ultimate person who is receiving the goods. Then that procedure can be followed. There is already a press release and a circular by the department wherein they have laid down the procedure that this e-way bill can be generated either by the real manufacturer who is supplying goods to me, or it can be raised by me also in order to conceal my margin.
Got it, sir. Thank you, sir. One more, Simranpreet Kaur, CA. If SSC is dealing in tax-free goods and submitting GST on RCM basis on GTA services, please confirm whether such tax paid under RCM and GTA service will be refunded or not.
There is no question of any refund. Once you are dealing in tax-free goods, There is no output tax liability. And because you are liable to pay tax under reverse charge on GTA services, then in terms of Section 24, you are compulsory liable to be registered. So my humble submission is there is no question of any refund being made available. Refund Section 54 is applicable. Only refund with regard to the credit is available once it is an inverted duty structure or it is an export of goods, not under any other situation. There is a way where you can avoid your liability of getting yourself registered also. You can say, you issue me, so you can request your supplier to issue you the paid GR and charge the transportation charges in his invoice because you have to bear that expense. So let us say the value of the goods is 100 rupees, 5 rupees is transportation charges. Rather than making payment of 5 to the GR, you request your supplier to make that payment of 5 to the supplier and let him charge that 5 rupees in the invoice and you pay 105 to the supplier. By doing so, you are avoiding your tax liability and you are avoiding your liability to get yourself registered also. You are circumventing Section 24 also. Aapko registration karane ki bhi zarurat nahi hai aur koi tax dene ki bhi zarurat nahi.
Got it, sir. Sir,
a second defense is also available. You can choose a transporter who is charging tax at full rate of 12%. In that case, also, you are not liable to get yourself registered because in that case, it is not a liability under RCM. So in that case, also, you can circumvent this problem. And in case you are dealing in tax-free goods, my suggestion will be to follow any of these two methods and don't get yourself registered.
Sir, in similar line, there's another question from our fellow members, CA Shri Agarwal. SSC has taken on hire buses for his office employees to and fro from home to office and back and paid GST at the rate of 5%. Whether he is eligible for such GST input?
I think we have to look at the section 17.5 clause because travel, where the hiring of vehicle, motor vehicle, etc. has been barred. That is clause B1. I think this slide is not latest one and I'm handicapped. So you kindly look at that clause. According to me, it is barred. You cannot claim the credit.
Okay, sir. Sir, one is regarding input. CA Bhagwat Dayal ji has stated in has questioned, in case of dividend received, should SSC reverse proportionate ITC?
According to my humble opinion, no.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, this is one very important question with regard to the relevant position of COVID-19 and lockdown. If one is dealing in perishable goods and in lockdown such goods got perished, what about GST input?
I have already told you, okay, once it is a natural process of loss, there four words have been used: goods lost, stolen, destroyed. It doesn't fall any of them. Return off is a tricky issue and return off dictionary meaning doesn't cover this situation. According to me, he shall be eligible for the credit. Most of the time it will happen because the shops are closed nowadays. You may have certain chemical which has got a time limit of this thing. First of all, they will go to the manufacturer and ask for the replacement. If there is no clause and the company refuses to do so, I don't think I need to reverse the credit. In my humble opinion, he is entitled for the credit.
Sir, as you have stated that he should go to the manufacturer. So whether he is required to provide such process that he has done such process that he has...
No, it is not. Certainly not. It is only a question of tax for which he is claiming the credit. Otherwise, the whole thing is a loss to him. As a common sense, I can say it's a force majeure clause. If you have supplied me the goods which I was supposed to supply and the material has come only 2 days and then by lockdown, which is a compulsory enforcement on me, I could not open my shop, I could not lose it. It's a question of mutual arrangement. They may share the loss depending upon their negotiation capabilities. So it is not required. It is not required. He can claim the credit.
Thank you, sir. What is CA Pankaj? He has a query. If registered dealer is selling the goods at a price which is less than the price at what he is bought for. Say, for example.
Absolutely no problem. Dekhiye, Section 15 says the transactional value shall be accepted only two conditions. The party should not be related and price should be the only way. Let us say, now it's a technological thing. Every day, new models of the mobile are coming. I'm having a stock of, let us say, Samsung X in mobile. I know why mobile is likely to be launched in next 2-3 days. So this mobile will not be sold. I can sell it at a lower price. Unless otherwise, the department is able to prove that you have taken the consideration outside the books of account or you have taken any undue advantage from there. For example, that phone, if you are genuinely selling for 9,000, you have purchased for 10,000, no problem. But you are issuing the invoice for 9,000, 2,000 has been taken in cash, or he is the person who has provided you some service, some benefit in kind, which is not being recorded in your books of account, then you are in trouble. Otherwise, there is no problem.
Sir, then there is no question of reversal of ITC.
Absolutely not.
Thank you, sir. Sir, another question from CSK Agarwal. What will be the treatment of input if amount written off of balance outstanding of supplier?
Balance outstanding of supplier, I don't think. The only thing is you have to make the payment within 180 days. You are writing off the payment of supplier means you have not made the payment. If you have not made the payment, to that extent, credit has to be reversed. I told you in section 16.2, four conditions.
Yes, sir.
And after that four condition, payment has to be made within 180 days. Okay. If I'm writing off some amount of the supplier, so that means I have not paid him for the supplies.
Got it, sir.
If I have not paid him, to that extent, reversal is otherwise required.
Sir, then we are also required to pay the interest on that also, since the amount has been reversed after 180 days.
Certainly, without fail.
Sir, there's one question, request from CA Pavan K. Aravall. He's from Dehradun. Please cite certain examples where interest at the rate of 24% shall be levyable in case of wrong claim of ITC.
There can be a number of situations. Right now, I am not going to give invoice-wise detail when I'm claiming the credit in 3B. I'm having an invoice where the interest tax rate has been charged 18 rupees. I claim 20 rupees otherwise. While doing my calculation, it's a wrong claim, excess claim. There can be n number of situations. I am having an invoice of 1,000 rupees, 180. I fabricate 1 lakh and 1,800. Again, it is the same situation. I claim block credit, motor vehicle, I claim the credit. So now, once it is specific bar, I am claiming it without taking confidence into the department, without intimating with them, and without challenging the provision. So obviously, I am claiming that credit which is not due, a specific credit, motor vehicle specifically barred. So barred credit is also one situation. There can be n number of situations.
Sir, one question is from CA Amit Sodhi. His queries is regarding input availability on civil structures. That is office building, plant,
hotel. Certainly not. If you are using it for your own purpose, I discuss that matter. We discussed the judgment of Odisha High Court in the case of Shivaji retreats also. So I have discussed that matter at length. So premium is not available.
Thank you, sir. Sir, is one more period we received just now. If returns for financial year 2018-19 is filed now in March 20 only, whether we can claim input credit on purchases or it will lapse as not claimed by September 2019.
Here I will say we had got a place to contest with. I might have filed my return late, but those invoices must have been recorded in my invoice in the month in which they have been received. So availment of credit has already been done. I am only utilizing it in the month of March 20. According to me, that credit which has been availed in the books of accounts properly, we can avail that credit.
Thank you, sir. We have, sir, some questions on gifts also. Whether gifts given on Diwali to the employee is subject to reversal of GST credit?
Dekhi, gift to related person without consideration can be supply also. If you look at Schedule 1, employee is a related person, number one. Number two, they have given an exemption of 50,000 per employee per year gift. If those gifts fall within that limit, then there is no problem. Otherwise, it will be a deemed supply rather than reversal. We will have to pay the tax at the market value of those supplies.
Sir, goods written off, especially due to change in fashion or change in technology, as you have stated, for garments or for mobile phones, whether they do attract reversal of GST credit?
Certainly not. If those goods you are not able to sell, you will sell it as a scrap or you will scrap it. You are not giving it to give to somebody else, or you may reprocess it and use it for any purpose. So certainly reversal is not required.
So if RCM of 2018-19 is paid now, can we take credit?
In my humble opinion, no.
No. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful time. I thank you for your precious time, sir.
Sir, two, three questions are more, sir.
Sir,
one question is ITC. Can a pharmaceutical company send free samples to a domestic customer, third party, an intercompany, export third party customers, or export intercompany customers? Please suggest what to do with ITC of these cases.
ITC has to be reversed. The only thing is from where you are distributing the sample. Even if I want to distribute the sample to my distinct person, I can distribute the sample from here itself. I make the transaction recorded in the financial statement of the factory itself. In that case, the quantum of reversal can be less. What I was debated upon is how to minimize the reversal amount. I never said reversal is not there. So reversal has to be made. So my humble suggestion is, in case you pass the entry in the manufacturing unit, then certainly the credit reversal will be less. I have already discussed in detail. If I am distributing it through my unit, then the unit is not liable to get a credit for the same. Then even benefit of second provision to Rule 28 is not available. So only the fair market value I have to reverse the credit. That is the issue.
Sir, if the commission has been paid for zero rated goods or exempted goods, whether I can get input credit of both or whether I'm supposed to deny some input credit.
Because zero rated goods means the goods have been exported.
Yeah.
So there is no doubt you'll get the credit. Exempted supplies means you are making some supply which are not subject to GST locally. If you are doing that, then this service has been used exclusively for exempted. So in terms of Rule 42, credit is not available. But I have given another view of the interpretation 17.1 and 2. If you take that enterprising view, then you may claim it. But certainly the department will object to it, and time will only tell what the court will take the stand on.
I believe I've done with the questions. Sir, if you can sum up the things within 2 minutes or 3 minutes, what is to be done next minute? Within 2 minutes, what are the issues normally come to you? Normally, what mistake professionals does?
Nitin, I got it. Whatever is my little bit experience in dealing with the indirect taxes matter, I say the one who is claiming the credit on ambitious basis, by and large, judgments are in favor of the SSC. The only thing is substantive condition must be satisfied. There must be input service of capital goods used in the course of business. It is not personal use or non-business use. Then you should claim the credit unless otherwise specifically barred under 17.5. 17.5 is a great problem. Even was contact when it was there and I'm claiming it and Odisha High Court is allowing it to me. 16.4 time limit is there and people are challenging it. So by and large, you should claim the credit. Forget about anything else. If you prima facie feel that it is for the course of business and not for personal use and otherwise, you must claim. 17.5 is very, very important. Once again, I'll say.
Is there anything anybody want to ask? Okay. Sir, I must acknowledge, sir, mere ko thank you ke message aa rahe hain ki thanks Nitin, itna acha webinar तूने कराया. उनको ये नहीं पता कि who is the speaker के हिसाब से webinar अच्छा हुआ है. It is all due to you, sir. All due to you. मैं आपको बताऊं, सर, मेरे पास करीबन 200 मैसेज हैं. मुझे लगा कोई क्वेश्चन पूछ रहा होगा. हर बंदा बोल रहा है, इतनी क्लैरिटी से समझा रहे हो. क्वेश्चन 4 या 5 आए, वो मैंने सुमित को व्हाट्सएप कर दिए. तो उस हिसाब से और मेरे कुछ क्वेश्चन सुमित को बोला, 2-4 बना ले कि कुछ तो पूछेंगे, वरना सर लिटरली इतनी क्लैरिटी से. और दिस ऑल थैंक्स टू यू सर. द रिस्पॉन्स come to us for these seminars, very frank, is always owe to you. We always owe to you. Thanks a lot for accepting our...
Nitin, that was the situation when I was young and I was in services. Now there are so many learned authors on GST. I'm only one of them and I'm doing my duty to...
Sir, Tendulkar ek hi hai, sir. Tendulkar ek hi hota
hai. My best of
sir, seva aate rehte hai, Tendulkar ek hi rehta, sir.
Chariye, sir. So nice.
Thanks a lot, sir. Let us, I request all the attendees and thanks a lot to you. Let us meet tomorrow. Kal, I believe the topic is valuation and classification. It has to be done by Ashish Chaudhary, and the moderator will take care of this session. Please join us on a right time. Aur jo log join na kar paye, meri unse request hai sir, please YouTube ke CA Nitin Kanwar wale link pe jaake वहां पे कर लें और अपने फ्रेंड्स को भी बता दें.
विद दिस मेरी छोटी सी रिक्वेस्ट नितिन, कैन यू मेल मी ऑल द टॉपिक्स इन द डेज टू कम एंड द नेम ऑफ द स्पीकर.
सो व्हाट आई विल डू, मैं आपको सर मैं अभी ना अभी अभी एक घंटे बाद ना सर आपको पैनलिस्ट ही बना दूंगा, सो दैट यू वांट टू वॉच यू कैन वॉच इट एट योर विश, राइट?
ठीक है सर, थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू
बाय, डू नथिंग लाइक इट सर.
I'm really thankful to Bhadra ji. I'm really thankful to all panelists, Sikandar ji, Deepak ji, Amarjeet ji, Puneet ji, Kapil ji. And from the bottom of my heart to all the listeners, viewers on our this the screen and basically on the YouTube. I'm also thankful to Knowledge Tree and Global CA for such a wonderful platform. And once again, thank you, Bhadra ji, for your kind support and time. Thank you, Deepak ji. Thank you, Sikandar ji, again. And please, be there with us always. Thank you, sir.